Well, it was basically 6 years ago that we started this project. It was an idea that came initially from Deepak, who is an old friend of mine from National Institute of Engineering in Mysore. And Deepak and I are both Bangaloreans, so is Dr. Sekhar once he joined the Indian Institute of Science. So we have a lasting interest in Bangalore and we've seen Bangalore change a lot. So we want to do something and help find some solutions for its many problems, including water and traffic and air pollution and so on. And Deepak had this idea about urban metabolism and it captured my attention a lot. And that's how really we started working together again. Because we used to work maybe 25 years ago in college together and we had a chance again to work together. Our main goal with the whole project to start with was to raise the level of understanding of Bangalore's relationship with water to a level that was sufficient enough, adequate enough to informed policy making. And in that context, we've been working for about 6 years, generating all kinds of data sets, putting up applications on our dedicated website. And one of those applications is the GeoPortal. And the GeoPortal is built using open source tools and free and open source tools for the most part, except some of the charting, JavaScript and so on. And my colleague, Douglas Wang, he works with my SEI sister office in New York. He's a web developer and basically he's been involved sitting out there in my New York office in England and developing and putting up all this information that we want to develop and helping me develop the designs of the interface and so on. And the GeoPortal is basically one way that we are publicly disseminating all kinds of data and information about the city that are related to the city's growth as well as to water, water infrastructure, water supply, water demand. And we call it a GeoPortal because it's visually, it's, you know, spatial in nature. And we've tried to provide all kinds of visual cues like charts and richness of coloring the data and things like that so that people can intuitively get an idea of what's going on when you log into that portal and see the city, where it's growing more, where it's not grown so much, where more water is coming in, where there are more wells, things like that.
The reason we attempted to put all of this data in the public domain and on a publicly accessible website is to be able to harness citizens as actually problem solvers. Right? And it's very important to keep in mind that this is such a complex conundrum that it is crucially important to involve everybody in the city, all the citizens in the city, because experts' solutions are simply inadequate. Right? I mean, experts can help lay out a deliberative framework. Experts are involved in so far as trying to put the different pieces of the hydrological puzzle together, but experts are not the ones who are going to be imagining what Bangalore might look like 10 years from now, 5 years from now, or experts are certainly not the ones that should be charged. I mean, technocratic experts shouldn't be charged with actually determining questions of who gets water. Those are inherently questions that should be democratically deliberated. Right, so we are attempting to provide such a technical platform. You don't like what you see? It just means that you need to go back and fix your institution. Right, so the BUMP project is primarily aimed at getting people in Bangalore, citizens in Bangalore, from being mere consumers into engaged citizens that are actually engaged in understanding and perhaps even contributing to solving the water conundrum. Right? I mean, that's the principal aim of the BUMP project. So one of the things that you will find currently on the website is the nexus between water and energy. Remember, Bangalore gets its surface water for 1400 million liters a day from a source that is 100 kilometers away and half a kilometer below Bangalore. That's a lot of energy for pumping. Right? So one of the things that we've been attempting to do is to integrate the distributed groundwater model and superimpose the energy requirements, right? So that you get a spatially disaggregated portrait of where energy is being used. Right? I mean, you'd be surprised the significant contribution that just domestic water makes in terms of simple carbon emissions. Even as a simple hydrology problem, this is very complex. You cannot simply reduce Bangalore's water conundrum to a technocratic engineering problem. It is hydrologically, right, simply a disaster to look at these two systems, the groundwater system and the surface water system, as if they were unrelated independent entities. Right? The first sort of institutional recognition from a hydrological perspective would be to recognize that groundwater and surface water are intimately related to each other.
Bangalore is like an inverted saucer to kind of sense, where the center part of the city is in an elevated region, whereas the outskirts essentially are sloping down, especially in the southeast and southwest, are going down into lower topography. And so that is the reason why southeast you have a basin starting towards South Pennar and the southwest is going into the Kaveri Basin. We wanted to understand, is there a good groundwater flow from the central part of the city to the outskirts? By doing a network, we quickly figured out that the central part of the city has a very shallow groundwater level, where the water is brought from surface water systems. Areas where there is no surface water brought in, especially in the, as I said, in the outskirts, where even though it is at a lower relief, the groundwater levels are deeper. So this is again anomalous in terms of hydrology. Usually, you know that in a hydrology textbook, you would see that areas in a lower relief would have a shallow groundwater table. Areas with a higher relief will have a relatively deeper groundwater level. But in this case, humans have modified the hydrology a bit. Since they were using groundwater in the outskirts more, the groundwater levels are deeper, whereas the usage of groundwater is much lesser in the central part. It is shallower. So that means we have created a more stronger gradient of groundwater system from a higher, usually water is moving from a higher elevation to a lower elevation. So in this case, groundwater is shallow in the upper part and the relief is higher. And then here the groundwater is depleted, and even though the relief is lower. So that means the gradient of groundwater is much higher than the topographic gradient. So you have a good opportunity for water to travel from the center of the city to the outskirts, or in this case, lower relief region. So our interest was to understand how much of this water is going. So by measuring, we know that this is the behavior pattern. Now the next question is, considering that these are the granitic gneissic rocks of different characteristics, we may have a lot of fracturations, and considering all that, what kind of hydraulic conductivities are in play? We know the gradient, and so we needed a model which analyzes what is the kind of flux of water going from the center of the city to the outskirts. So in the sense that groundwater is like traveling from the center to the outskirts, probably in the form of akin to a pipeline. Water is getting transported from the middle of the city to the outskirts, and what quantity it is. One of the other hypotheses which we were looking at is to understand how the extreme events are playing out. Typically in a groundwater system, we are not always looking at extreme events like rainfall. Groundwater is not affected by extreme events in a rural environment. That means, what I mean by extreme event, you have a high rainfall, for example. We had a huge rainfall in August last 15 days in Bangalore and in the first week of September. So these kind of storms are often not happening. You will have a typical rainfall and so on. So if you have a high storms, what happens in a common and agricultural environment is you will have a huge runoff, which will be a flood and which will get carried away out of the system. Through the streams, it will go away. So we call this as a flood events. And in very little would recharge, because when you have an extreme rainfall of high intensity, most of it will not percolate into the soil and it is runs off. But a city is completely different. In a city, what happens is that this water which falls cannot go away from the city so quickly. There are so many inhibiting factors for this water to go away. That's why you see all the water stocked in the city in various flooding, etc. You will see in the newspaper suddenly lots of events. So that means there is quite a delay in this water getting flushed out. So you are creating a lot of opportunity of stocking the water for several days during such extreme event, creating or provoking an opportunity for a lot of recharge, which is not commonly found in, as I said, in a rural or agricultural environment. So in that sense, the city system by itself creates a different recharge altogether for the rain. So our interest was, how is the recharge in a city augmented by, as I said, leakages, etc., added to that harvesting, plus how extreme events play a role. That means if I had a quick event in this week, am I seeing a huge recharge events? And if so, how much of water has added into it? And this helps us to understand how the extreme events can benefit the groundwater recovery in cities where the usage is also high. This kind of information about extreme event is something which will help us in future to understand if we had these extreme events don't happen every time, every periodically once in 3 to 4 years, how we may recover from the usage in a normal years is something which we are looking at investigating. This also has an additional aspect in the sense that if we know that groundwater levels go extremely high in some places, that will also be a cause of understanding how to manage the subsurface flooding, to understand which locations have a subsurface flooding more. And so accordingly, not only looking at a drainage from a stormwater drains, we should also think about a super drainage mechanisms like a underground drainage of the water through tunneling, etc., like you manifest in a transportation network. One of the hypotheses which we were also looking at is to look at what kind of future groundwater levels and what is the future groundwater patterns it would be. So if we know how the demand side is playing out, typically the demand side happening with new areas, more populations, more demands, and as other water systems, for example, the amount of fresh water brought into the city is changing, the demands on groundwater would change. So by looking at the demand side projections, we are interested in projecting the demand side patterns in different places, combining population, combining the future surface water planning in the system, and also the amount of groundwater use for the depending upon the economics of the system and so on. By combining all of this, if we have a trajectories of the groundwater use in different pockets or the wards of the city, combining with the future recharge likely to happen from the climatic events, one can ask what should be the groundwater levels, because we have a math model for the whole city, for every ward piece, to say how the current groundwater levels are with this kind of demand and with this kind of recharge. And going forward, if this is the recharge and this is the demand, how the groundwater levels would pan out. So that is called a projection or a forecast, in a short-term forecast. Because most of the climate models which give you the information about rainfall, etc., and also the projections of groundwater use cannot be projected too long. So something like about 5 to 10 years in the first step, one can project them and see how these projections are happening. That will also give us an idea about which particular regions are more vulnerable. That's the goal in terms of trying to look at how this information goes into the BUMP project.